Namaste there. Welcome back to another session on Passage to India. So in the last class, we had discussed about the first stanza of the poem Passage to India. Kindly note, I had mentioned that the entire poem consists of 277 lines and it has or it is divided into 9 stanzas. So please correct, we have 278 lines completely. Okay, please correct it. Moving on to the first stanza that we had just discussed, just a recap of what actually happened in the first stanza. So when this stanza opens, we see that the poet Walt Whitman, he is singing about three achievements of his time, and the time is given as 1860s. Okay, and I hope you know what are those three achievements. He is talking about the opening of Suez Canal, then the opening of transatlantic cables, which was used for telegraph communication. Then he also talks about the opening of a transcontinental railway. Okay, and so he says that we have to celebrate this moment of achievement, that mankind has literally reached up to such a point that we could invent all these achievements. And at the same time, when he praises the achievements of the present, he says that we shouldn't forget the importance of the past. And past is actually given too much of importance over here. He says that without the past, we can never ever reach to the very status that we enjoy in the present. And he says that the past, the story of the past is actually hidden. We just can't imagine the depth that it has. And it is all because of the distinct thoughts of our ancestors. Okay, they have been striving hard in order to reach or make reach our humanity to a position that we are going to enjoy in the future. So we have actually, this is of course, these three achievements are of course a milestone. Okay, and we have reached this particular level of technological scientific advancement just because of the very force which is impelled from the past. The force is of course the thoughts, dreams and aspirations of our ancestors, of those engineers, those scientists, those architects, those sailors and explorers who lived before us. Are you getting it? And I hope that was clear. Just a few more idea I just want to add about our first stanza is just like this. We have a clear case. So we had discussed about a transferred epithet over there when we discussed eloquent cables. Do you remember that? I hope so. Other than that, we have a case of oxymoron coming over here. What do you mean by this oxymoron? Oxymoron is actually a case in which two contradictory terms come together. So we have in the first stanza itself, we have a coinage like strong lights. When we read the word strong, we have a feeling like it is something heavy and bulky, but it is combined with the word light. So it is just light that is called strong. So that is an example for oxymoron. Okay, then we have the cases of repetition. Repetition actually happens throughout the poem, but coming to the first stanza, we have the word singing. Okay, but that is being repeated. We have the usage of this word past coming over again and again. When we move on to the second stanza, we have the use of you. Third stanza, we have the use of your, and other repetition instances we will discuss while we move on to other stanzas. Okay, another literary device that Whitman has employed in this particular stanza, and the first stanza was that of personification, and throughout also he personifies Saul. He actually talks about he actually uses the word cry when he talks about Saul. Only a human body can cry. I mean, they correct. Over here, Saul is actually being personified. And we have many instances of alliteration that is coming. Okay. So let us move on to a detailed discussion of the second stanza of the poem. Now that we have discussed what actually happened in the first stanza, When the first tense ends, we have a reference to the relevance of past. And with that idea which is given in front of us, he just moves on to talk about the importance and how precious is the fables, myths and legends of Asia and Africa. So moving on to the second stanza, he is actually trying to emphasize, okay, or give more prominence to the past that we have, that unfathomed past, unfathomed retrospect that he was talking about in the first stanza. Okay, so he says that together with praising the achievements of the present, he was talking about the Suez Canal, Transatlantic Cable, Transcontinental Railway. So when you just praise, okay, the achievements of today, you have to keep in mind these are not only the way to reach up to God. Okay, there are also, you know, these legends, these myths and the fables, okay, which are there in Asia and Africa, these deep diving Bibles, okay, these also help us, okay, these also point towards a world of spirituality. So, you know, this is, many might feel like this is a novel idea, okay, that Walt Whitman is trying to, you know, incorporate into this particular poem. But of course, there are many poets who had actually made use of this idea. If you have studied Brooklyn Bridge, there is, of course, such an idea coming over here that a bridge is something, it is a product of science, of course, it is a product of engineering, technology and all. But as a poet, Hart Crane actually talks about or gives a kind of transcendental capacity to that very bridge. And he feels like the bridge would come down to the level of common men. Okay, especially that he was a gay person of his time. And during his time, you know, such human beings, they never got the kind of recognition that they have right now, what they enjoy right now. So people were against them. So he says that this Brooklyn Bridge, okay, it will come down to the prayers of common men like him and fill the gap that even religions couldn't fill. So that's, of course, you know, a similar idea that we can find. Well, moving over here, Walt Whitman is also talking about such a kind of an idea. Don't you feel like, you know, he is talking about a different worship. We normal human beings, we are actually concerned about religious worship only. When we are born from within the family, we learn, okay, what is religion, what is God, what kind of a life you have to lead, and or we learn ethics, morality, everything out of our religion. Okay, we keep ourselves intimate with God and all. So over here, he is actually talking about another form of worship. Okay, these achievements, okay, when man actually accomplishes this particular achievement, this is also taken as a prayer. And what is the importance of such a kinds of a prayer, such a kind of a religion? Actually, science opposes religion. That is, there is such a kind of a concept, okay, especially after First and Second World War and all. Science, scientific inventions and all that, especially with the publication of The Origin of Species by Darwin too. Science was always opposing religion. But moving over here, he says that, you know, these inventions, these achievements of science, okay, through that he's talking about a religion. Like the same religion that is taught in our religious scriptures. Okay, this is a worship new that he is trying to sing with us. So not only our religious texts lead us to God, these achievements can also lead us to God. And how is it? Okay, because, you know, he I had already mentioned about that Miltonic vision that he incorporates into this particular poem. So accordingly, when Adam and Eve fell from the paradise, the progeny, their vast progeny, that is including us all, according to the religious beliefs, we are actually wandering around on the surface of the earth. Okay, we couldn't get back to the paradise. And through these achievements, we are actually connecting all of us. Are you getting it? This is how it becomes a religion. He talks about unifying whole world, and these opening of Suez Canal, Transatlantic Cable, Transcontinental Railway, we overcame our geographical limitations with this. Okay, so we are actually reaching to give our hand to all the human races. Are you getting it? And if we go forward with such a kind of an advancement, what happens is the unification, okay, of the world will ultimately come true. We are, okay, if you take the surface of the earth, we are divided into different geographical areas, many a time because of the geographical setup that is already there, okay. Ocean separates us, mountain ranges, they separate us, but we have to literally overcome all these barriers and try unifying the whole world. And these three achievements are actually praised with this idea in mind, and this is the new religion that he is talking about, okay, unifying the whole world. Well, I hope that idea is clear. Moving on to the second stanza. The second stanza starts like this: Passage, O soul, to India, to exorcise the myths, Asiatic, primitive fables. So again, over here, India is used as a metaphor. India represents a spiritual kingdom. And according to Whitman, he is in high praise for the land India. And he feels like India has already achieved this the kind of transcendentalism that he is actually trying to convey over here. The kind of mysticism, okay? The kind of spirituality. India, the land India, contains that idea of spirituality. So he actually asks the soul to accompany him. Passage, O soul, to India. Why should you go to India? Why should you visit that spiritual kingdom? To exorcise. Exorcise means to clarify. Are you getting it? To clarify the myths, Asiatic, okay, all the myths and legends and fables of Asia, the myths and primitive fables of Asia, because he feels like these myths and fables, you know what is the meaning of a fable? Fable is, of course, a story which has a moral and a didactic end to it. Are we getting it? So, the Asiatic and the primitive fables. So, let us passage to India so that we get a clarity about what is being said, what is being taught in these fables and the myths of Asia. Not you alone, proud truths of the world, nor you alone, you facts of modern science, but myths and fables of eld, Asia's, Africa's fables, the far darting beams of the spirit, the unloosed dreams, deep diving Bibles and legends, the daring plots of the poets, the elder religions, all you temples fairer than lilies, poured over by the rising sun, all you fables spurning the known, eluding the hold of the known, mounting to heaven, you lofty and dazzling towers, pinnacled, red as roses, burnished with gold, towers of fables, immortal, fashioned from mortal dreams. You too I welcome, and fully the same as the rest. You too with joy I sing. This is the second section of the second stanza. So, he says that, not you alone, proud truths of the world. What are the proud truths of the world he is mentioning over here? The three achievements that he had been already mentioned. Okay, he had been mentioning already. Not you alone, proud truths of the world. Nor you alone, yea, means you facts of modern science. The three achievements again, okay. Nor you the facts of modern science, but myths and fables of eld, the word E-L-D, it's all English. Eld means old, O-L-D. Asia's, Africa's fables, that means primitive fables. But myths and fables of Asia and Africa, the far darting beams of the spirit. Okay, so What he is trying to convey over here is this: you scientific achievements, when I celebrate you, okay, you are not only the only ways or the only means which talks about spirituality, which talks about the way to reach God. There are these myths, okay, but myths and fables of Eld, Asia's, Africa's fables. So, but the myths and the fables of old Asia and Africa, the far darting beams of the spirit. Dart, you know what is a dart? Dart is actually a small pointed arrow like okay object that you actually use, make use, you will be throwing it onto that particular point in the game of darting. Okay, the far darting beams of the spirit, he's talking about religions over here. Okay, the far darting beams of the spirit. Earlier, do you remember in the second part of that first stanza, he was talking about like a projectile which was formed, impelled from the past. Like that, he is talking about that far darting beams of the spirit. Okay, he is talking about the religions over here. The unloosed dreams. Unloosed over here means distinct. Okay, definite and distinct dreams of our past. The deep diving Bibles and legends. Okay, Bibles, you know, he is not at all talking about the word Bible or legend over here. He makes use of the term Bibles and legends. So that means that he is actually addressing all the religions, all the religious scriptures of the world. You're getting it? Deep diving, that is why he has made use of deep diving, and deep diving itself is a case of alliteration. And I hope you know what is alliteration. Alliteration is a case in which two sounds or two letters they come together at the beginning of a word. Okay, over here deep diving, DD. Okay, it's a case of alliteration. So the deep diving Bibles and legends, he refers to any religious book, any culture. Okay, the daring plots of the poets, the elder religions. See, he again talks about the importance of the poet. See, he had actually started talking about or standing or taking the role of a singer. Do you remember I had actually told about a difference between singer and poet? See the relevance that is given to the poet over here. See the daring plots of the poet. So he is actually giving a power to the poet that poets are have also. Okay, poets have also strived to bring about this element of spirituality to the world. You're getting it? Daring plots of poets. So all the poems, all the scriptures, everything that is written by the poets, they also includes the same spirituality. Okay. Oh, the daring plots of the poets, the elder religions. Elder means very old religions. Okay, religious scriptures in many religion are written by a particular poet. Okay, a particular religious time. A particular religious person or a prophet. Are you getting it? So like that. Okay, they had also incorporated the spiritualities. You just see the role of the poet over here. Oh, you temples. Fairer than lilies poured over by the rising sun. You have to remember, temples over here refers to religion. Okay, so he compares religion to a temple, and you have a beautiful case of imagery over here. See, temples fairer than lilies poured over by the rising sun. You just imagine the case of early morning in which lily flowers have blossomed, and that early sun's rays, you know, sun actually pours its rays onto the lily flowers, and it will be having those dew drops, on its edges, and it will sparkle. You just imagine how bright and how shining it would look like. Okay, so oh temples, he says that temples, that is the religions, they are fairer than the lilies. Okay, so they are more beautiful, they have more importance than, they are more beautiful than the lilies, which are actually, which shine in the morning sun. all your fables spurning the norm. Okay, spurning, spurning means over here refusing. All your fables, in the sense like, you know, you take any religious text, you imagine like you read it at 10 years old, you are 10 year old and you are reading it, you will get some kind of interpretation according to your knowledge and wisdom of the time, and try reading it in 20 years when you reach your 20s. Again, you start getting many other levels of meaning, okay, in between the lines and all. And when you read it in 30, it will be different. When you read it in 40s, 50s, 80s and 90s, okay, the interpretation keeps on changing. So why is it happening? Are you getting it? So it eludes the norm, okay? However, we try to comprehend the ideas inside a religious text, the myths, fables and legends. The meaning is actually hidden. Okay, we can't literally extract the exact meaning or all the meaning that is there inside any religious text. Okay, well, so all your fables spurning the norm, eluding the hold of the norm. Okay, at 90, when you are in your old age, okay, you might be reading your religious text. And you might feel like, okay, I have literally gone through each and every line and I have literally came across with all levels of meaning. But still, that meaning is incomplete. That's why he says eluding the hold of the norm. You feel like you know everything. You have a hold of all the meaning, but it eludes. That's the nature of the religious text. Well, mounting to heaven. They reach up to heaven. You love and dazzling towers, pinnacled red as roses. Over here, red as roses is a case of alliteration. R and R coming together. Burnished with gold. Burnished is a case of apostrophe coming over here. In the first stanza too, we have similar cases of apostrophe, okay, in which we skip certain sounds. When we discussed about that unfathomed, formed, imbelled, etc. Over there too, we have cases of this apostrophe. Over here, we have burnished. Well, so you lofty and dazzling towers, okay? You religions, you precious religions, pinnacled, okay? Pinnacled over here means, see, over here, these religions are compared to towers, the fables, the myths, the legends. These are compared to towers, and pinnacled means it just stands high. Okay, pinnacle is actually that point, top point of any tower. It just stands high. And they bloom, they blossom, okay, they shine like red roses. How beautiful it is. Burnished with gold. You just imagine, it's a kind of imagination that you have to take some effort. You have the red roses over here and it is burnished with, it is decorated with the gold, okay, polished. It is the red rose, which is already beautiful, it is polished with the gold. Oh my goodness. So he makes these legends, Bibles, which are of course referring to the past, something great. Well, you too, I welcome, and fully the same as the rest. And what is the rest? Of course, he addressed reality in the beginning. I mean, they correct, Suez Canal, Transatlantic Cable and Transcontinental Railway. So he's actually, in a way, mixing together reality with his own idea of transcendentalism. I mean, they correct. Well, you too with joy I sing. Okay, so he started the poem like the singing my days. And when we move on to the second section of the second stanza, he says that I also, when I sing with joy, when I celebrate the achievements of today, I am also celebrating all the importance that it has. What? Those deep diving legends, myths, fables of the past, the religions of Asia and Africa, the myths and legends of Asia and Africa. Okay, so over here he says that, see, modern miracles of science, they are all part of a divine plan. Are you getting it? The poet sings of a new religion which will combine scientific achievement of the present and the spiritual attainment of the past. So this is the different legend he is trying to tell us. He combines the scientific achievements, okay, of the present with the spiritual attainment that we had already have. Okay, well, moving on to the last portion of this particular stanza. Passage to India, Lo Sol, seest thou not God's purpose from the first? The earth to be spanned, connected by network, the races, neighbors, to marry and be given in marriage, the oceans to be crossed, the distant, of course, brought near, the lands to be welded together, a worship new I sing, you captains, voyagers, explorers, yours, you engineers, you architects, machinists, yours, you, not for trade or transportation only, but in God's name and for thy sake also. You're getting it. This is how he ends the second stanza. So when he ends the second stanza, he's actually trying to tell us that, see, can't you see? Okay, when I just went on explaining all these, that scientific achievements of the present and that spiritual attainments, okay, that is spiritual attainment that we already had in the past, we are still having. Don't you feel like Lo Sol, he's again addressing the soul over here. Personification comes to play. He addresses the soul as a living being. Okay, Lo is actually used for calling attention. Okay, Lo, that it is actually used as an expression to call attention of somebody. Okay, Lo Sol, seest thou not? THOU thou means you, YOU. Okay, haven't you seen? Seest thou not God's purpose from the first? Haven't you seen? Haven't you seen the purpose and plan of the God from the very first with all these things? Already it is given in our past, in our religions. Okay, and when we literally juxtapose it with the achievements of the present, can't you feel like we are actually fulfilling the same divine plan that was already there in our world? Okay, the earth to be spanned. So what is that divine plan? The plan actually goes like we have to span. Span over here means cross. Okay, earth to be crossed, connected by network. Okay, we are completely in a disintegrated form. We have to combine. Okay, we have to unify, and for that we have to cross earth. We should be getting connected by networks. The people to become brothers and sisters. Okay, become brothers. It's a case of alliteration again. BB coming over here. The people to become brothers and sisters. Over here he talks about the amalgamation of culture. Okay, this was actually taking place in America when he is actually composing this particular lines. Okay, he talks about that very amalgamation that is actually happening. The races, neighbors, to marry and be given in marriage. The oceans to be crossed, the distant brought near. Okay, so you know, when we went for the construction of Suez Canal, we are successful right now. So we had crossed oceans and we had brought the distant places near to us by doing that. And there is a hidden plan of God who is actually standing behind us, okay, forcing us to accomplish all this, and he accomplishes this through time. So this is actually the setting of this particular poem. Time is the setting. We do not have a particular point of time. The setting actually travels from the past, okay, in the present, and it goes on to the future too. Okay, it's indefinite. Well, the lands to be welded together. So this is the divine path. Sorry, divine plan. We have to weld together all the lands. We have to accomplish the total unification of the world. My goodness. A worship new I sing. And so he says that over here, I am actually singing about a new religion. Okay, you captains, voyagers, explorers, yours. He talks about, he actually calls everybody who took pains behind the kind of achievement, okay, that we have just witnessed. You captains, voyagers, explorers, engineers, architects, machinists, okay, you, not for trade or transportation only, okay, common man might think like they might have a misconception that you just build all these things, you constructed all these things just for trade and transportation only. But it is not just for that, okay? There is a different religion behind you, knowingly or unknowingly. I told you already, I believe we shared the same in the first answer, that he is trying to address that idea which was not in the mind of these architects. They may be unknowingly doing all these things, okay? So over here he says that the achievements that you have accomplished, they just do not stand for trade and transportation only, okay? That is again a worship to God. You are doing your duty. That is your worship to God. You are actually becoming the hands of God in achieving that divine plan that he had been keeping, okay, from the very beginning. Well, you know, for trade and again, one more, the trade and transportation over here is again an instance of alliteration, TT coming over here, okay. But in God's name and for thy sake, O Saul, okay. So he says that you engineers, you architects, you scientists, you machinists, you shouldn't only think about your achievements, okay, that you have already finished doing as something that will be sufficient for trade and transportation only. But you have to take it like that, okay? You have accomplished this all in the name of God. It is for God. It is to fulfill his divine plan that you did all this. Okay, so with this, we have come to the end of the first stanza. We will discuss the next stanza in the next session. Thank you for listening. I hope you have understood. If you have any doubt, you can mail me. Okay, or you can place it in the comment box below. Thank you then.